middle of January, so we might as well go to space. Hello there, everybody. Welcome to episode number 616 of this here electronic engineering podcast called Amelia's Weekly Fish Fry, brought to you by eejournal.com and written, produced, and hosted by me, Amelia Dalton. This week, my guest is Ralph Grundler from Aitech. Ralph and I are talking all about OpenVPX in space. Ralph and I discuss the increasing role that open standards are playing in space applications, how OpenVPX supports a systems-based approach for these types of designs, and how OpenVPX can be used to support a variety of AI applications in space as well. So, without further ado, please welcome Ralph to Fish Fry. Hi, Ralph. Thank you so much for joining me.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Okay, so we're talking about how OpenVPX is transforming space applications today. So, Ralph, before we dig into the solutions in this arena, where are you seeing open standards play a role in space applications?
Well, open standards have actually played a role in space applications for a long time. We've been involved in open standards based applications, starting with PCI, compact PCI. That was a very popular standard, and there was 3U and 6U versions of that, and that have been highly adopted. In fact, it's been so successful, it's really hard to get the space people off of that because it's worked, it's proven, they have the software for it. So those are the kinds of things that open standards can do for you. And so space has built on top of those, and I'm sure you're familiar with Ethernet. Ethernet is a huge open standard that is highly adopted in space as well, too, or starting to get highly adopted in space as well, too. So that's one example of something that's up and coming.
Okay, so let's talk about the space digital backbone. Talk to me more about that, and what elements are included in the backbone, and do these elements contribute to a connected infrastructure?
Yeah, exactly. Whenever you talk about a digital backbone, this is actually a term that we borrowed from the military. They're very into using this digital backbone. And the idea is that you're using Ethernet or some kind of serial interface to communicate between different devices in your complete system or in your complete vehicle, if you will. You know, in your house, it's very obvious that you would use Ethernet or Wi-Fi to connect and talk to things, and you have different devices being connected. You would probably be really shocked how many devices you have connected to your Wi-Fi once you take a look at it. And the same kind of thing happens with a military vehicle where they have this digital backbone and they can add things on. And so this same kind of concept has been applied to space and successfully, I might add. There's a few satellites that are up and flying right now. One of them is CITIS Space. They're taking advantage of Ethernet and using an Ethernet switch and then adding edge processors. For example, one is processing images using NVIDIA Jetson TX2i controller. And so they basically have this NVIDIA GPU that's processing their images. So now if you think that, for a vehicle, it's a little more simple where that, you know, I have this vehicle, I want to add a feature to it. So now I have this digital backbone that I can add features to it. And maybe there's some other type of edge computing or some other type of computing that I need to add. And then the process of adding it's a lot easier. And the whole concept of space, it has kind of morphed into this, everybody's building a satellite with a payload. And then so now the payload bus has become this kind of digital backbone. So that's where it's all kind of connecting and convalescing. It's all kind of converging in space, and it's being really successful and making space kind of more modular and easier to connect.
Sure. So let's talk about a systems-based approach. Now, how is OpenVPX supporting this endeavor? And talk to me more about that.
Yeah, so for each one of these systems that you would connect in this digital backbone, they're actually little, we'd call them kind of subsystems on their own, whether it's, just what kind of system functionality are you trying to achieve with that? And for example, it could be The easy one always is Earth Observation System, because that's something everybody can relate to. It's visual, but there's a lot of other systems that you could use to view either Earth or view out into space, or even to view in front or behind you as you're orbiting Earth or even going deep into space. So OpenVPX is one of the standards that we're going to leverage, and we're going to leverage this for mainly kind of LEO applications or applications that don't require redundancy. For example, if you have a short mission that goes out further or you're weight limited, by leveraging OpenVPX, it's already a standard where there's a lot of hardware already out there that you can connect to and build your digital backbone to. So in terms of this system itself, OpenVPX allows you to provide different functionalities inside the computer that you could use for different applications.
So, Ralph, AI is becoming more and more important for space applications. So, talk to me about how we can use OpenVPX to support AI in space applications.
Yeah, so OpenVPX, that standard gives you a defined interface in terms of bandwidth and what you can communicate on, and it's expandable. And what's happening is now you can take your OpenAI system and add in some kind of GPU processor. And this GPU processor could be, for example, an NVIDIA-based one, or there's a neuromorphic processor that you could also add, which will also process AI. And so again, what you're doing is you're building out your system so that you can add AI functionality, and then AI can provide you a lot of different kinds of functionality that we can't even imagine right now, but some of them could be object avoidance, could be methane gases on Earth. It could be detection of ships or of whales or other things that we want to track on Earth, for example. So AI is a very interesting thing where it can analyze a lot of data in a very short period of time and give you just the core information that you're looking for. So OpenVPX can be leveraged to expand your systems to help with that.
That's great. Now, do you have any other real life applications you can share in this arena?
Yeah, so there's several real life applications. I think I mentioned, the obstacle avoidance. I think that's always the one that's primed everybody's mindset because space is getting more crowded. The good thing about space is there's a lot of space in space and it's three dimensional, so people can move around pretty easily. The thing you have to be careful about, though, is not using too much fuel or not moving into another location that would cause you to crash into something else. And so that's where AI can really help, can analyze a huge amount of data to help you with that. One of my real life examples for a customer, I kind of mentioned it briefly before, is Citus Space with their LizzieSat-1, and they're using AI for methane detection. And what they're detecting is emission of methane gases from different sources. And people are required to report their methane gas, and typically they're too high or too low. But from space, you can really definitively tell exactly what that amount is. The other real life application was NASA did a reusable heat shield. And so this is an inflatable reusable heat shield. So you can imagine that it's small when you shoot this up in a device, but it becomes very large when it inflates and then protects the vehicle that you're trying to re-enter back into Earth. And what the cameras were used in this case were to look at the skin of the re-entry vehicle to make sure that there were no anomalies on the skin. And this is what AI is really good for, is checking for anomalies, right? Checking for things that are different, right? It's not part of the normal expectation. The other real life applications could be also for system docking. Those are another great example of something that could be almost completely automated in terms of a flight control. And there's other things that are similar to that as well too.
So, how is Aitech supporting OpenVPX for space applications?
So currently, we're coming out with a new computer, actually. We're calling it the SP1. And this new computer will actually support OpenVPX. And the idea is that you would take this computer and then build a system around it. For example, you would add, an analog board to control some analog functions of the spacecraft, or you would add an AI board, for example, to have some AI functionality for the spacecraft. All in support of whatever that mission is. This unique thing about OpenVPX is it gives you that flexibility to build a system that will meet the mission requirements of the customers. Everyone's not stuck with the same system. You can modify it based on what the customer needs. And OpenVPX gives you that flexibility to have different cards that have different functionalities that allow you to give you this kind of MOTS system, if you will. It's a modified off-the-shelf COTS. So we build off-the-shelf boards, and then the system's modified to meet the customer's requirements. And then you can go through environmental testing and provide the customer a completely sealed box that provides the exact functionality they need, but still trying to keep them in that lower cost COTS kind of price range.
That makes sense. All right. Well, Ralph, it's time for your off-the-cuff question. So, if you could have one meal right now, it doesn't matter if it's on the other side of the world, you need a passport to get there, what would you have?
Wow, that's a great question. Yeah, I would definitely go to sushi in Japan. In fact, there's one particular restaurant that I've gone to several times, and I know the chef there. So that's always a lot of fun. And it's kind of more than just sushi. He also brings these small dishes and of different types of fish or vegetables that are just exquisite in themselves. So that's always for me is some kind of light small dish that you can really get the flavor out of is always wonderful for me.
I love that. What a good answer. Well, Ralph, this was super cool. Thank you so much for joining me and talking all about space and OpenVPX.
Yeah, thank you. And look forward to working with people on their OpenVPX systems and hopefully making them successful in space, like we've done with literally hundreds of customers. And so far, and I don't know who's counting this, but 2 trillion miles and no failures. I hope we can make more people part of that.
Well, folks, that's all I've got for this week's Fish Fry. If you'd like more information about AI Tech, OpenVPX, or the Embedded Tech Trends Conference, I've included a couple links below the player on this week's Fish Fryin' page on eejournal.com and in the description for this week's YouTube episode as well. Hey, have you checked out EE Journal on social media yet? Well, you should. You can find us at facebook.com/EEJournal. If LinkedIn is more your thing, you can follow us on LinkedIn too. And we are now on Blue Sky Social and Mastodon as well. And we have a YouTube channel, youtube.com/EEJournal. Folks, it is chock full of all kinds of techie videos, including our very popular Chalk Talk webcast series, hosted by me, and our animated series called Libby's Lab. And of course, you can subscribe to our EE Journal YouTube channel as well. Make sure that you subscribe to this here podcast on Spotify, Podbean, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, or just about any other podcasting platform to listen to some exciting upcoming episodes. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. If you know of any cool new technology or heck, you just want to chat, shoot me a line at Amelia, that's AMELIA, at eejournal.com, or post a comment on our forums on EE Journal. For the week of January 24th, 2025, I'm Amelia Dalton, and you've been fried.